legal theory. And because the word theory, it is not appreciated. That is what I feel.
Now, what is the meaning of jurisprudence? But before we analyze what is the meaning of jurisprudence, we as law students, we will try to find out what is the meaning of law. What is the meaning of law? Law means it regulates the code of conduct of humans. So the human behavior is controlled. Like suppose the human behavior of driving, then the law tells us how to drive. The human behavior of entering into a contract, education, going to places, public, private, what to talk, what not to talk, off scene, all these things the law regulates. There is not a single sphere of human activity which is not controlled by law. Let it be marriage, let it be divorce, let it be children, let it be maintenance, let it be the acts of doing anything, education, everything is controlled by law. We have our liberties, but they are very constrained by law. So law is like this. Now, we have many types of laws, we have many classifications of law. So let us take one classification of law, that is the substantive law and the procedural law. We have many classifications, but one major classification, substantive law. What is the meaning of substantive law? Substantive law means that law which concerns itself, or the content of that law is substance. So what is the meaning of substance? Means the law confers powers or rights or liabilities or duties. So these are the contents, or this is the substance of this particular law. When the law deals with powers, immunities, liabilities, rights, duties, liberties, such a law can be classified as substantive law. When these rights are violated, when the power is transgressed, when we have overstepped a particular power, or we have not performed the duties, then what is to be done? Then again the law comes to our rescue. We have another set of law which prescribes the procedure for the people, for the lawyers, for the judges to follow in order to restore those rights or give a certain remedies. Such a law is called as the procedural law. So procedural law prescribes the procedure to be followed by the individuals, by the lawyers, by the judiciary to enforce the rights, to restore the rights, or to give certain remedy. That is called as the procedural law. So what are the kinds of substantive law? Substantive law means constitutional law. Does it deal with rights? Administrative law. Administrative law. Law of contract. Indian Penal Code?
No. Procedural. Nay. Substantive. CRPC and CPC.
Indian Penal Code. Indian Penal Code is the main substantive criminal law of India. It deals with rights and duties. So any law which is dealing with rights and duties, it is called a substantive law. So Indian Penal Code, contract, torts, all these laws can be categorized as substantive laws, because substantive law deals with substance, that is rights, duties, immunities and powers. Okay, now what are the procedural laws? Yes, the criminal procedure code, the civil procedure code and evidence. Evidence also a procedural law. Now where is jurisprudence here? We have not taken only the name of jurisprudence. We have taken intellectual property, environmental law will fall here. Cyber laws will fall here. Where is jurisprudence? Here only we have CRPC, we have CPC and we have evidence. So where is jurisprudence? Jurisprudence is that particular subject which has given us this classification. It deals with the law itself. It is that subject which has given us the classification of substantive and criminal law, or procedural law, or civil and criminal law, or private and public laws. This classification, one subject constitution has not stated. It is jurisprudence. So jurisprudence deals with law itself. It deals with law itself. So if we want to know what is a substantive law, where do we find? We find it in the jurisprudence. Yes, in the subject of jurisprudence. Another classification we have, civil laws and criminal laws. So what is a civil law? A civil law is that law in which the remedies are compensation and damages, and the private individual can sue. What is a criminal law? Criminal law is that in which the remedy is in the form of punishments. So fine is there, but it is in form of punishments, and the state initiates the proceedings. But who has given us this classification? What is the civil law? What are the characteristics of civil law? It is none other than jurisprudence. Private law, public law. What is a public law? Public law deals with the relationship between individual and state. A public law deals with the relationship between individual and state. What are the types of public law? All those laws wherein the state is there and individual is there. So that is called as public law. Private law, it governs the relationship between two individuals. So what is the example of public law? Constitutional law. Does it describe the relationship between individual and state? Yes, because it gives us the fundamental rights. It also gives the power to the state to take away the fundamental rights. So it is in fact dealing. Administrative law? Yes, because it speaks about law rights also, and it speaks about the powers of the administrator also. Indian Penal Code, it is a private law or a public law? Indian Penal Code is a public law. Why?
Individual state initiates.
And the state in criminal law, it is a state which initiates the proceedings. So it is a public law. Law of contract?
Private.
Why private? Because it deals the relationship between two parties. And those contracts which are with the government, then they do not fall under law of contract. They fall under constitution. Okay, because it is the president or the governor who enters into the contract. So this is how civil, criminal, public, private. And what are the private laws? Private law only deal with the relationship between two individuals or two parties. This classification we get in the subject of jurisprudence. Then what does jurisprudence deal with? It deals with law. But what about law? So the questions as to what is law? What is the origin of law? What is the source of law? What are the types of laws? What is the nature of laws? What are the limits of laws? What is the scope of law? What is the validity of law? What is the function of law? All these questions are answered by jurisprudence. So what is law? What is the source of law? What is the nature of law? What are the limits? What are the functions of law? What is the extent of law? What is the object of law? What is the subject of law? All these questions are answered by jurisprudence. That is why it is said that the meaning of jurisprudence means it is knowledge of law. When we have to answer all these questions, what do we get? We get knowledge of law. So jurisprudence means knowledge of law. Knowledge in all its perspectives, in all its angles, not just one angle. In the entirety. This is the meaning of jurisprudence. It is also called as legal theory because there are certain theories of law which prevail. That is why it is called as legal theory. Now, jurisprudence can be divided into two parts. For the sake of convenience, for the sake of understanding, we can divide jurisprudence into two parts. One, we call it as the theoretical part, that is all the theories are based. And the other, we call it as the conceptual part, that is all the concepts are based. One is the theoretical part and the other is the conceptual part. What are the theories? These questions, what the law is, what is the source of law, origin of law, limits of law, extent of law, function of law, all these questions are answered by particular experts which are called as jurists. And through their theories, they have answered this question. Somebody speaks about the origin of law, somebody speaks about limits of law, somebody speaks about function of law. All these questions are answered in the theories, and that is what is called as the theoretical part. So the first theory which comes, I am just introducing the concept of jurisprudence. So I will not deal with any theory in detail, that will do later. The first theory which has come up is called as the natural law. This was the first theory which came, which tried to analyze what the law is. But they also have followed the principles of research method. So the title should give an idea as to what the content is. So natural law. So here the idea is this, the notion is this, that the law is originating from the nature. They have simple argument of natural law jurist. They have simple argument that is, man is a part of nature and he should be governed by nature itself. But somebody who can govern? Only somebody superior to man. So who was superior to man? God. So here the law maker is the God, and the nature is such a thing, it is such an element that it is through nature that the entire people are ruled. This is the concept of natural law. So here, the law is made by God. Now, does God come down and make the law? No, it is made through religion. It is made through religion. So previously, there was no distinction between law and religion. They were the same. They were the same because the nature of law or the form of law was religion. Today, the nature or the form of law is legislation, precedent or delegated legislation. But in those days, it was just the religion. So they have this argument that it is the nature who comes, or it is the nature who should rule. That is why natural law, if there has to be a law, they consider law as an external agency. And religion is an internal, religion, morality, it is an or customs, they are internal agency of control. Law is imposed, but culture, custom, we follow because we want to follow. So it is an internal mode. So even if there is a law, then that law has to spring from the nature itself. So there are this natural law can be divided into three classifications. That is the ancient natural law. Ancient natural law is such a law wherein the jurist states that the law comes through nature. And that nature, it is Aristotle, Socrates and Plato, that nature is that the law should be based upon reason. It should be based upon reason. So even if the law is made, the law should remain, should be based upon reason or the consciousness. This is what all of them say. So in the ancient natural law, it is that the law should be made through reason, and only God or the religion should make the law. The man, he doesn't have power to make the law. He can only apply the law which is made through reason or through consciousness. This is the argument of the ancient natural law schools. Then characteristics more or less they are the same. Then the medieval Saint Thomas Aquinas, he says that if religion is going to make the law, or if the law is based upon religion, then who is in a better position to tell what the law is other than the church? Because who explains the tenets of religion? Not the king, but the church. So it is the priest or it is the church who should have a major say in making and implementation of the law. Then came the era of Renaissance. I will take all this in detail later. Renaissance, that means some new light came up, because this is supposed to be the dark age wherein the law could not be analyzed. We had to accept the law as it is. Here we could, if suppose there was a particular offense, then it was regarded that the offense is not against a human being. Suppose there was a murder. Suppose in this era, suppose A had murdered B, then this was not not an offense against the individual person. It was against the nature. It was supposed to be the offense against the nature. And then nobody had to do anything about it because the nature would punish A. The time of punishment would not be known. The form of punishment would not be known. But there is a certainty that A would be punished. So what would happen to him? He would die in the same manner, or he would lose his son or daughter, or he would miss some, you know, he would lose something valuable or some other loss, or he would fall sick. Any types of punishment would be attributed by the nature. But when? This year, next year, this birth, next birth, not known. But it was certain that he would be punished. So punishments were inflicted by the nature. Now this thought was a little depressing. And then new light came in Renaissance, wherein we have Hobbes, we have Locke, we have Hobbes, and we have Rousseau, who they say that there should be some person, there should be some person. Even if the law is made by nature or by God or by religion, there has to be a particular person who interprets and applies the law. So this was the Renaissance era. Now so much talk about religion and God, that means religion and law were the same. The religion and law, they are identical, they are the same. So much talk about God, religion, few people could not accept this, and that is why entirely opposite theory came, which is called as the positive law. So here, if the law is made by God, here they say the law is made by man. If here it is said that the law is uncertain, in the sense that the time of punishment not known, form of punishment not known. No, here they say it is absolutely certain. It is absolutely specific. That what is not specific or certain, it cannot be a law. So here for the first time, they tried to analyze the law. They tried to analyze the law. So it is also called as the analytical school. It is also called as the analytical school. It is called as the positive law, or the positive school, or the positive thought. The word positive itself speaks volumes. The title gives an idea about the content. What is the meaning of positive? Certain. We ask, are you coming positively? Means certainly. So here, certainty has to be present. If it is made by man, certainty has to be there. Specific, definite, nothing vague, all determined, what the law is, what the source is, what the punishment is, when the punishment will begin, everything analyzed in detail. So the first was Bentham, then was Austin was the student of Bentham. So first Bentham, then Austin. It has wrongly been said in certain books that Austin is the father of jurisprudence. No, Friedman and Dias both say, if you want to give the credit of father, it has to go to Bentham and not Austin, because Austin is later. Bentham, Kelsen, and Hart, they belong to the school of positivism. They have different ways of analysis. And they have tried to analyze. Once Bentham speaks about certainty, specificity, and he says legislation is the sole source of law. He does not accept custom as a source of law. He does not accept precedent. He says judge's duty is not to make law, just to apply the law. Whose duty is to make the law? The legislator. So let the legislator do its duty. Where is the need for the judge to make the law? So Austin, Bentham, he speaks about legislation. Austin, he has taken certain thoughts from Bentham only and tried to modify it, and he has given to analyze what would be the law. Like, there would be three aspects of law: sovereign, command, and sanction. And if these three aspects are not fulfilled, then that law would not be a law. So on so forth. What is the command? Kelsen speaks about how the law has to be originated. So he wants the law to be pure. He wants the law to be pure. How the law, how it can be kept pure? Pure means law is law. Law cannot be mixed with religion, political science, economics, psychology, sociology. They are separate branches, and law is pure law. So he wanted to have pure law. Hart, he has developed the concept of law. He says what the law would be. He also has used marvelous analytical method to make us understand that how the law, from where our fundamental rights come from. So he has also tried to explain the concept of law in his, the name of the theory is only Boucolier's concept of law. So this is positive law. Then we have another school that is called as the sociological school. Here, now the law is made by God, the law is made by man. Now he says, Roscoe Pound says, the law is made by society. So it is called as the sociological school. The law is made by the society. He says, the function of the law is to protect the interest. The function of the law is to protect the interest. His theory is also called as the functional school or the functional approach, because he says the function, why the law has to exist, because it has to perform a particular function, and the function of law is to secure the rights, protect the rights or the interest. So to protect the interest, the law is created. And how he has to protect, how the law has to protect the interest? Just like an engineer. So as the engineer builds a particular wall with the help of bricks and cement, like that, bricks are the rights and cementing is the law. So the every law has to cement a particular right, that is secure a particular right of the individual, and there has to be no conflict in the society. This is what Roscoe Pound says. So he has given us classification of interest, state interest, public interest, society's interest, individual interest. He has given us a classification. Once the interests are classified, they have to be balanced so that there is no conflict in the interest. Then we have the other thought, that is the economic interpretation of law, or we have Marx's theory, Karl Marx. Here he says, Marx, according to Marx, who makes the law? Money. So those who own the means of production, they make the law to their own advantage. So to analyze, money makes the law. Those who own the means of production are in a dominant position, and so they make the law and they will implement it to their own advantage. This is Karl Marx. And he goes to the status that one day will come when the law and state will wither away. Wither means vanish away. Now, Marx was not included in the scope of jurisprudence. His theory is for economics. But when all were trying to analyze what the law is, Marx got up and said that one day law and state will wither away. That means the whole exercise of finding out what the law is wasted. That is what the jurists tried to study, that really, is it going to happen that one day law and state will wither away? But no, it was not that. His theory withered away. Then we have the historical school. Historical school. Historical school, main founder, there are two, Savigny. He says that the law is, if you want to find out what the law is, then we have to study the history of the society. His famous sentence, law is not made, but it is found. Law is not made, but it is found. Found where? Found in the customs. And what are customs? Customs are seen, are felt in the history of that particular society. That is why the historical school. Henry Maine is the other part, but Henry Maine has just compared. So that is a different aspect. But Vaughan Savigny. So Vaughan Savigny says that the law is not made, but found. Found where? In the customs. And customs, how do we define customs? They are followed from the
past.
Yes, times, antiquity, not known. Antiquity means not known. If a particular practice is followed from not known antiquity, it is custom and it is recognized as a source of law. So he says there should not be any legislation, only customs. And if legislation has to be made, then the basis of that legislation has to be custom. Because he says if legislation and custom are in conflict, then it is the custom which the people will follow, not the legislation. Why? Because customs are the internal agencies.
Therefore,
of governing.
It is not implemented.
So,
because
custom.
People feel that dowry system is more.
Dowry is a custom and it is internal. And legislation is imposed because it is external. So, when there is a conflict, then internal source always prevails. Because we want to do, because we have to do it. Our internal thing, you know, we want to do it. But here it is imposed. So, he says, direct in contradiction with Bentham. Here he says legislation is the source. The only source of law is legislation, according to Jeremy Bentham. Whereas Vaughan Savigny says the only source of law is custom. So he says custom should prevail over legislation, and Bentham says
legislation should prevail
over customs. Then we have another school, that is the realism. Realism thought, or the realism approach. They say, we will tell you really who makes the law. It is called as a realist approach. Realist means factual, actual, real approach. They say, don't argue who makes law and what and why. We will tell you really who makes the law. So according to the realist approach, who really makes the law is the
judges or the judiciary.
When a legislation is made according to Bentham, what is the interpretation of that legislation is the real law, and this real law is made by whom? By the Supreme Court judges. Then who really makes the law? Even if it is custom, whether a particular custom is recognized in a particular society, who will tell?
Yes.
Then who makes the law? So they say the name of the school is realist approach. Really, actually, factually, who makes the law? So Article 21 is just two lines. But what does it mean? What is life and what is liberty?
So sanctioning agency actually makes the law. No.
Not sanctioning. Judiciary is not sanctioning. Mm. It is, their main task is only to adjudicate, that is to solve the dispute. But while solving the dispute, they interpret the law. So here the main source of law is what? Precedent. So legislation, custom, and precedent. So here the main source of law is precedent, because judges make the actual. All these are guideposts, legislations, customs, they're guideposts. That means they're guiding or they're, you know, like giving directions as to what the law would be for the realist approach. There are two types of realist approach. One is the American realism, and the other is Scandinavian realism. Both say that the law is made by the judges, but the American realism says that the law makes the judges upon the factors which are behind the judge. And the Scandinavian realism say that the judge makes a decision on the factors which are before him. This is the difference. We will do this when I come. Now, anything else is left from where the law originates? We finished with God, we finished with man, we finished with societies, with money, with history, with judges. Anything else left? After analyzing everything, still the jurists were not happy as to really who makes the law, what is the content of law, what is the nature of law. And they came back to this concept, that is the fourth aspect. We call it as the 20th century natural law, wherein they said that, no, there is an element of nature in the law, plus the law is made by man. So it is a combination, it is a little combination of these two concepts. Like the concept of justice. Justice is inherently concept of natural law. Justice comes from where? From legislation or from nature? We want a particular person to be punished. This thirst is where? It is in our consciousness. We feel right when the offender is punished. So is it due to some legislation, or it is due to our consciousness which is within? So it is from the reason, the consciousness, the nature. Concept of justice is inherent in the natural law aspect. So it is correct. But then the law has to be made by legislation. So part of positivism. So here they say that law and religion are the same. You ask them, what is law? This is law. And what is a religion? This is a religion. So the form of law was religion itself. Either the Hindus or the Muslims or the Christian, the canons of the church were the laws, the tenets of the church were the laws. So here Here they say, no, it is absolutely different. Two different. This is law and this is religion. Two separate areas. But for the neo-natural, they say, no, it is not like that. We have law over here. We have religion over here. And there is some area where law and religion overlap. For example, murder. Murder is prohibited by law. It is prohibited by religion. Theft. Misappropriation of property. Telling lies on oath. So law also, when there is breach of contract, that law also prohibits. Religion also prohibits. So there are certain areas which are overlapping. But then there are certain technical areas of law wherein you have to file a particular case in a particular court with a particular format, affidavit. It is technical, peculiar, where it is only law. And typical, peculiar religion, whatever worshipping of God, nature of puja, it is typical religion, there is no question of law. So there are these areas of law. All the questions, what is the nature of law, source of law, validity, function, limits, extent, everything is answered by these theories, any one of the theories. Any legislation or any case of the Supreme Court especially has to be based upon a particular theory. It will not happen that a particular decision, so many times the Supreme Court refers to a particular theory, that is the application of the theory. If we cannot apply a particular theory, that is our mistake. It is not the jurist's mistake. Every legislation or any Supreme Court case, we give a ratio or the obita and we will be able to tell you on which theory it is based. So, this doesn't mean that they are only theories. They are in practice. When you say that the legislation is making the law, yes, then we are following Austin and Bentham. When we say that, yes, custom is a source of law, we are following Savigny. This economic theory, it has got very, very less application, so not about this. But otherwise, then how can we say that jurisprudence has got no application? This is one part of jurisprudence. Now let us come to the other part, that is the conceptual part. What are the concepts of jurisprudence? Like in research methods, I had told, we have to identify certain concepts upon which our thesis is based, or which concepts we use often in our thesis. We have to identify the concept before so that there is a clear meaning to the reader. In the same manner, the legal system means the entire society in which all the laws prevail, it is like that. This is the society and all the laws, the civil, the criminal, all environmental, all the laws prevail. So there is a system. This system is called as a legal system. So legal system means all the laws containing or prevailing in that particular society or state. So when we read or when we analyze all the legal systems, we find out that all the legal systems are based upon certain concepts. There will be no legal system which does not deal with certain concepts. So those concepts are brought together and the meaning of those concepts are defined in jurisprudence. So any legal system using any concept, the meaning is same as which has been stated in jurisprudence. So this is research methods on a wider scale. So all the legal systems will use certain concepts and each legal system will have the same meaning of the concept which has been defined in jurisprudence. So what are those concepts? Those concepts are like rights. Will there be any legal system which does not speak about rights? What are the types of rights? What is the extent of right? There may be a difference from legal system to legal system, society to society. But the concept of right will prevail in every legal system. Duties. What are the duties? Powers. What power the government enjoys, the legislature enjoys, the judiciary enjoys, the government official enjoys, or other types of power, the landlord enjoys. Every legal system will talk about powers? Of course. Liability? Yes. How will we hold a person, the wrongdoer? So both the liabilities, the civil liability as well as the criminal liability. Under the civil liability, the civil remedies, everything, compensation, damages, specific relief, injunction, everything. Criminal liability and the penalties under the criminal liability. All the punishments, form of punishments. Then we have liberties, right and liberty. We have liberties. We have immunities. Immunity, certain people are immune from certain action. So who is immune? How much the immunity stands? What is the extent? Can we start the proceedings, criminal proceedings against a particular person who is sitting in the chair of PM? No, he is immune. First he has to resign, and then Mr. So and So, the charges are leveled against him, but not against a particular designation because it is immune. So immunities, privileges, so many privileges, parliamentary privileges, judicial privileges. So what is the meaning of privilege? In which section, in which article, in which statute it is mentioned? We have to go to the study of jurisprudence. Then ownership. What is the meaning of ownership? What are the aspects when we speak about ownership? What all it includes? It is a bundle of rights. So when we own, what do we say?
Position.
We can, yes, then we can do anything with that property. We can stay in it, we can lend it, we can sell it, we can give it for lease, we keep it vacant, we can, these are the rights. So it is called as bundle of rights, ownership. There is no law saying that you own it, no, so you have to do this only. You can do anything with your particular when you own it. What is possession? What is possession? So possession in law, possession in fact. In fact means I am actually possessing this pen, but I may not own it.
Tenant.
So what is possession in fact, possession in law? Sometimes it may happen that we don't know what are the contents in our house. So does it mean that we do not own them? We have an intention to own them, though we may not know also of their existence, or we may have forgotten. So what is possession in law, possession in fact, what is adverse possession, de facto, everything, possession. Then we have ownership of personality. Personality, natural personality, legal personality, corporation, company is what? University, legal personality. So if we have a legal personality, we can own a property. We have rights and duties. So legal personality of unborn child. Does an unborn child have a legal personality? Yes, he has got a personality. Personality of the dead, those who are dead, do they have legal personality? To a certain extent, yes. We have a right to dignified funeral. We cannot do anything with the dead body. It is their right, plus will after death only, because he has got that right, that is why the will can be executed. So there is personality of the dead also. Then we have many more, but then we have justice, concept of justice. Where is justice defined? What are the theories of justice? It is defined in jurisprudence. Now, so many, all these terms are somewhere or the other used in the statute or no? And still we say it is only theoretical. Isn't it irony? Show me a particular statute which does not deal with this concept. Any one of them. And then you say jurisprudence is theoretical. Is it theoretical? It is the foundation of every legal system. No legal system can survive without the elements of jurisprudence. The only thing is that it is in foundation, so it cannot be seen. Just like the building. Who sees how depth the foundation is? We only see how high the building is. But the depth determines the height of the building. Like that. The principles of jurisprudence determine the quality, the modernness of a legal system, the refinedness of a particular legal system. This is the study of jurisprudence. But in our series, I don't know whether because it is a very lengthy process, but then I will confine to the theories. If time prevails, then we'll talk about the concepts. But initially, because they are more difficult, and my aim is to make the theory applicable in today's time. How the natural law is applicable in today's time, Austin, Bentham, Kelsen, Hart, whatever, Savigny, whichever jurist, we have to show its application in today's time. So that would be my main focus of jurisprudence lectures.